Moinsen, this is Sebastian and I created an adapter that goes between your Game Boy and the cartridge to stream gameplay videos via USB. A few months ago, a Tetris enthusiast asked me for help. He needs to stream the Game Boy version of Tetris. Now, there are plenty of solutions out there, from modern devices with HDMI out, mods for original devices, or just using an emulator. But those would not work for him because he needs it for an online Tetris tournament. The thing is that the contestants need to play their own Game Boys on which they trained their muscle memory, and you cannot really ask each of them to modify their beloved Game Boy. Unfortunately, the Game Boy has no externally accessible connector or port to offer any information about what is going on the screen. Except, well, since the game comes in form of a cartridge, everything that ends up on the screen has to go through that connection somehow. So, I present to you the GB Interceptor. Not Game Boy Interceptor, that would be a trademark violation. It is an adapter that goes between the Game Boy and the game cartridge, like a Game Genie. It reconstructs the image and streams it via USB, acting just like a regular USB webcam. No drivers needed. Unlike a Game Genie, it does not influence the communication between the Game Boy and cartridge at all, as they are directly connected to each other. The experience is the same as if the Interceptor was not there, except for it being a bit bulkier than just the cartridge. The Interceptor only adds a few bus transceivers to the data lines to capture the cartridge communication with an RP2040, which is the microcontroller of the Raspberry Pi Pico. It can directly see the state of the 16 address lines, the 8 data lines, and the lines for clock, read, write, and chip select. One additional pin senses if the Game Boy is turned on. The rest is based on the minimal hardware example from the Raspberry Pi Foundation. An oscillator, some flash memory, a USB port. Well, I decided to use USB-C instead. But basically, we are looking at a Raspberry Pi Pico hooked up to the Game Boy's memory bus. At this point, anyone who knows a little bit of how the Game Boy works should be complaining that there is no video signal on that memory bus. It is just a memory bus. The Game Boy sets the 16 address pins to ask for data from a specific address, and the cartridge presents one byte of the data at the 8 data pins. The clock pin determines the timing of when a new address is set and when the data has to be ready. And that's it. No video signal. However, the entire code of the game has to go through this bus, and all the game data including the graphics. Unfortunately, we cannot directly see the data as it is in the Game Boy's video RAM. That is the part of the memory that represents the current image. The graphics unit of the Game Boy uses the data in video RAM to render the image, so that would have made things much easier. Instead, we need to follow along with the code that the Game Boy requests to recreate a copy of the video RAM. So, if the Game Boy receives an instruction from the cartridge to write a value to video RAM, we simply write the same value to our own copy of the video RAM. Well, usually it's a bit more complicated. Typically, those instructions tell the Game Boy to read data from a certain location, write it to CPU register, apply some operation, mix it with some other data, and eventually write the result to video RAM. This means that we need to emulate most of the Game Boy's CPU. So, in the end, I had to write almost a complete Game Boy emulator that is running on one core of the RP2040, while the second core emulates the graphics unit and pushes the result out via USB. Luckily, we do not have to emulate everything and can avoid some typical inaccuracies of emulation because we do not have to make any decision ourselves. We automatically see the exact instruction that the Game Boy executes, no matter if it is just the next instruction or the result of a conditional jump. This also solves the problem that we cannot see some I/O stuff, like, for example, such an unimportant thing as the gamepad input. Yes, we cannot see at all which button the player pressed. But it doesn't matter. If the A button is pressed, it will trigger some conditional jumps in the code until the Game Boy executes the code that makes Mario jump, and that eventually renders Mario in a different position. Our emulator will execute exactly the same code because it automatically only sees this code. It does not need to know that pressing the A button caused it. One could say that the GB Interceptor is an emulator on rails. Of course, not everything is that simple, since the Game Boy does not only read instructions through the memory bus, but also reads game data and keeps setting bus addresses even when it is not talking to the cartridge. We at least need to know at every moment which requests are an instruction, which are data related to an instruction, and which are just garbage while the CPU is still working on instruction. To achieve this, we may not miss a single one of the data packets on the bus, and we need to know exactly for how many cycles the CPU will work on an instruction. One of the trickier things here is detecting interrupts when the Game Boy suddenly jumps to a different part in the code and takes a few extra cycles to do so. Another tricky thing is keeping our emulated graphics unit in sync with the real Game Boy. In many cases, it does not matter much at which moment the content of the video RAM is drawn, but some effects rely on changing video RAM while the image is being drawn, like the tile address switch that I used to draw a full frame video stream with my Wi-Fi cartridge. Such effects only look correct if we synchronize the emulated graphics unit to the instructions that we receive from the Game Boy. This can, for example, be done by detecting a VSync interrupt or by recognizing a tight loop that reads the LCD position register and waits for a specific position on the screen. But games can use different methods to synchronize their code to the graphics unit. And a more exotic one will probably give strange results on the interceptor until I implement that method. Oh, and another tricky one is the halt instruction, when the clock signal is turned off and we need to use our own clock signal for the emulated graphics unit until the Game Boy wakes up again. Or the DMA operations, when the CPU copies code to high memory to execute from there until a block of memory has been copied to OAM memory. Okay, I think you get my point. Solving those details was a lot of fun, but let's talk about the results and how to use the interceptor. You first connect the interceptor via USB. Remember, it may not miss a single instruction, so it has to start first. On your computer, it shows up like a regular webcam, so you can view it with VLC, use it in OBS, or attend a Zoom meeting with it. Unfortunately, due to a combination of the RP2040 supported USB standard, compatible color modes, and the isochronous transfer mode I use, the video stream is limited to 29 FPS. But internally, the emulator runs at the Game Boy's native frame rate. After all, it may not miss a single thing. And the additional frames can be blended together, which emulates the old LCD's latency. There's also a mode button on the interceptor to switch between grayscale and retro greenscale, as well as turning frame blending on or off. I'm also thinking about adding a frame counter that is triggered at certain addresses in the game's code to time competitions and speedruns. But that is something for a future update. There are some limitations though. First of all, the interceptor does not emulate audio. If you need audio, you will have to get it from the headphone jack, which in many cases should be as simple as using an audio cable between the headphone jack and your PC's line in. Another thing you should know is that the interceptor only supports classical Game Boy games. It works with the Game Boy Color and the Game Boy Advance, but not with Game Boy Color games or Game Boy Advance games. Your Game Boy Color games might be possible if someone finds a way to heavily optimize my code, as those run at twice the clock speed as classic games. But at the moment, I'm even overclocking the RP2040 to keep up with the classic ones. Also, if you're thinking about using this to play on a big screen, you will notice some lag. It is not too bad, and internally it is only 2 or 3 frames, but it will be enough to annoy you while playing. The GB Interceptor is made for recording and streaming. In some games, there can also be some graphics glitches that are simply unavoidable with this method. I mentioned that gamepad inputs are invisible and that this is not a problem, right? Well, there are quite a few other things that are not visible and they are also not a problem for the same reason. Until they become a problem. An example is the diff register, which is a very fast internal counter that is often used as a source for random numbers. Most of the time, such a random number only causes a different conditional jump and different code to be executed, and it is no problem because we see the chosen code. This changes if the random data is directly used in video RAM. A harmless example is the garbage stack of Tetris. In game mode B, it generates some random blocks that you need to clear, and the decision if there is a block or not is actually the result of executing different parts of the code. No problem. But the look of those blocks is determined by a version of those random numbers directly written to video RAM. So look closely at the original image from the Game Boy and the interceptor. The layout of the garbage stack is the same, but the blocks have different designs. In rare cases, this can become a more serious problem. If we play Tetris in two-player mode, then the Game Boy that starts first generates the garbage stack. Here, the interceptor works fine with only different block designs. Unfortunately, the second Game Boy has to have the same garbage stack, and the first Game Boy sends it to the second one via link cable, which the interceptor cannot see at all. The second Game Boy writes the data directly to video RAM without checking any of it. So, we have no idea what the player is really seeing. Finally, there are some hardware differences among devices. My code partially relies on the Game Boy exposing data on the cartridge memory bus that technically does not need to be visible on the bus. In these details, there are minor differences between the classical Game Boy and the Game Boy Color, as well as modern clones like the Analog Pocket. For example, the Pocket deals with the stack pointer during an interrupt one cycle earlier than the original hardware. This is not relevant when playing a game, but it confuses my interrupt detection. But the Pocket has a dock with HDMI out anyway. So, in summary, I can tell you that I tested the Interceptor on a classical Game Boy, a Game Boy Color and a Game Boy Advance. For any other hardware, we will have to see. In summary, I would say it is not perfect, but most of the time it works very well and, as far as I can tell, it is the only solution if you want to stream or record video from your original Game Boy without modifying it. So, do you want to have one? The good news is that it is cheap. I bought material for 10 builds and it only cost me 25 euro per interceptor. Buying only one, however, will easily exceed 100 euros because of the setup costs for manufacturing. So order in groups. Also, I do not sell any assembled devices myself, but I will post a separate video with step-by-step instructions on how to order components and build your own interceptor. I try to make it as easy as possible. Order an assembled PCB, solder a single connector, drag the file that contains the firmware onto the device and add your preferred case. The only thing you need to solder yourself is the cartridge connector, and as I highly suggest ordering in groups, chances are high that one of you can handle it. In order to make it easy, I also did not solder the components myself, but tried the PCB assembly service from JLCPCB for the first time. Now, guess who contacted me after I showed the first prototype on social media and asked if I was interested in having them as a sponsor? Yep, JLCPCB is now sponsoring this video. If you have seen my Wi-Fi cartridge Q&A video, you might have seen that I switched to JLCPCB about a year ago, and I have never had any issues with them. Prices are fair and the service is great. They offer plenty of options for PCB prototypes in terms of technical properties, but also aesthetics like that popping purple color. And yes, my first assembly service worked perfectly. So accepting their sponsorship was a no-brainer for me. You will find an affiliate link in the video description, and if you know your way around Gerber files and electronics, you can just pick up the production files from my GitHub repository and place your order. But if you have never ordered any PCBs before, the process might look a bit intimidating. So check out my order and assembly video, in which I will guide you through the order process at JLCPCB, as well as uploading the firmware and building a case to get your own GB Interceptor. Speaking of cases, the minimalist version is very easy to build. Just get yourself an empty Repro cartridge from eBay, AliExpress or wherever you get your cheap plastic junk. Cut away the top and put the interceptor in there. Done. If you do not like that the PCB is still visible, I also have designed a 3D printed case, which is not ideal for the classical Game Boy as it gets in the way of the power button, but it works well with the Game Boy Color. See the order and build video for details. But most importantly, the PCB is designed to allow for creative case designs. It comes with a breakout board that allows for a free placement of the cartridge, for example by using a ribbon cable like this. So I really hope to see some alternative designs show up in the future. If you create something, let me know and I will happily host it or link to your design. Okay, I think that is plenty for a single video. I am actually surprised myself how well the Interceptor just works whenever I plug in a different game, and I really believe that I created something here that is worth for others to build and use. As always, I released everything under open source licenses and I am eager to see how many of you will build it, help fixing the little details that might not yet work for some games, or even improve my code. You can find many more details in my blog at There Ought To Be, including links to GitHub for the source and design files, and of course you can find the order and build video here on my channel. Until then, I'm out. Ciao!